Jaipur College, Kukas, any questions, please?
Yes, sir. Good morning. Good afternoon, sir. Sir, my question is, can temperature of the cold fluid rise above the inlet temperature of the hot fluid at any location in the heat exchanger?
Yeah, actually the question is, in heat exchanger, can anywhere the cold fluid temperature exceed the hot fluid temperature? Yes, I forget exactly what word that is called as, but yes, it can occur. Why? Because it is going in cross flow, and locally somewhere the fluid temperature can exceed, but that is locally only. That is locally, just because that the heat transfer coefficient there has become very less, because of which the wall temperature might have gone very high. So, other way around, the heat transfer coefficient somewhere has become very less, very high, because of which the fluid temperature has gone very high. I am not getting the exact word. There is a word for this. I have taught this in the heat exchanger course. Please put this question. This is called as some reverse factor or inverseness. I don't remember exactly. Yes, it can occur in few locations, but not in tube in tube, parallel and counter flow heat exchangers. It can occur in cross flow or shell and tube heat exchangers, where in which all sorts of in all sorts of directions the flow is taking place. Okay.
Okay, sir. My second question: the effectiveness of the heat exchanger can be greater than one?
No. Effectiveness of the heat exchanger greater than one? Never. The effectiveness of the heat exchanger can never be greater than one, because I have already taken the maximum temperature difference. How can I get more temperature difference than what I have taken? I can never get. Okay. Ruba College, Indoor. Any questions, please?
I've got one query. What's the difference between the effectiveness of heat exchanger and efficiency of heat exchanger? As such, effectiveness is the ratio of actual heat transfer to the maximum heat transfer. How one can define the efficiency? Can't it be like that? It can be the ratio of actual heat transfer to the heat transfer when we take the average temperature difference.
Okay, question is, why don't we define efficiency? Why do we handle only effectiveness? How can I take average temperature difference? Does the average temperature difference have any meaning? No. See, whatever temperature difference I take should have a meaning. It is LMTD if I take, it is varying. That is, if I take the temperature difference from hot side to the cold side, continuously there is a temperature difference. If I take average temperature difference, we said in convective heat transfer, if I take average temperature difference, I can be off by 15% to 20% or even more. That is the reason why we have introduced the concept of delta T LMTD. Question now, answer is, first part of the question answer is, we cannot take average temperature, number one. And where is the question of efficiency definition? Where is the question of efficiency? We have told already in terms of effectiveness. What is the ratio of the maximum temperature difference? Why we have defined effectiveness? Why not efficiency in terms of actual heat load to the maximum heat load? Why don't we do that? Because the temperature gradient is the one which drives it. So that is the reason why we have defined effectiveness but not efficiency. All this while we have been emphasizing all the time that whether it is constant flow heat exchanger and constant wall temperature case, or even counter flow or parallel flow heat exchanger, what drives is the temperature difference. That is the reason we have defined effectiveness as temperature difference. We have not defined efficiency as actual heat transfer to the maximum heat transfer. This is because the driving potential is the temperature difference. That is the answer. Okay. MES Pillai, Panvel. Any questions? I hope your audio is fixed.
Sir, one example you have taken. In that example, you have incorporated the heater at the bottom of the tank. Suppose I insert the heater at the top of the tank. So, the upper portion of the water will get heated, and the remaining water which is present at the bottom of the tank, that will be heated by the conduction only after some time. This concept is clear or not, sir?
So what you are saying is that we are having a geyser. In the geyser, I said that in the morning we are having a heater at the bottom. So that is, I have a heater at the bottom, and because of which the hot air goes up and the cold air comes down, and the natural convection current is used for maintaining the uniform temperature distribution. What if I have the heater at the top? What will happen? The water which is there here will get heated up, and the only way the heat can transfer itself to the cold fluid which is at the bottom is through simple conduction. So, it will take enormous time for the bottom water to get heated up, number one. Number two, it will perhaps not get heated up as much as this gets heated up. Okay? So, uniform, ultimately why are we heating? We want to get the uniform temperature distribution of the water, but that temperature of the temperature, uniform temperature distribution is managed or exploited, or we are able to generate that here in this situation, but not in this situation. Why? Because conduction is not as effective as natural convection. Okay? That's the reason. Is that okay? Kollapur?
Will you please suggest books on experimental heat transfer, sir?
Yes, that's what I am doing. That's why every day I am carrying, but I forgot to mention that. Please write down, this is the best book what I have got, and this experiment what I have given also is from this book. Please write this down and order this book for your library, or if you can purchase nothing like it. Experiments in heat transfer. Experiments in heat transfer and thermodynamics. Very difficult to separate out thermodynamics and heat transfer, although we teach them separately. Okay? Thermodynamics by, this is given by several authors. The experiment what I gave was by Professor Bejan, whom I like very much. Why? Because that scale analysis concept, he is a strong proponent of scale analysis concept. I like him very much. I am his great fan. So, this book is edited by Robert A. Granger. Robert A. Granger, Cambridge, University Press. University Press. Let me repeat, Experiments in Heat Transfer and Thermodynamics by edited. There are around 31 experiments listed here. There are 31 experiments, not all are very easy, starting from single phase to two phase flow, all experiments, interferometry, all experiments are listed out, but contributed, each experiment is contributed by an expert himself. Okay? So, this is a best book according to me, wherein which you can build setups on your own. In fact, that was the reason, good that you asked me this question. I wanted to tell every day, but I was forgetting because of so many things. So, I used to carry this book. I don't have the original with me, I have a Xerox copy of this, but original is in our library, but I think we have to purchase this book. Okay? So, I recommend everyone to purchase this book and add this to your library, and give this as projects, BTech projects for your students. Each experiment can be given as a BTech project for your student, or part of the heat transfer lab, you can give that as a project lab. Okay? So, if you give that, it will be very good. Little higher end book if you want, there is another book by Goldstein. This is again experimental heat transfer by Goldstein. I'm not too sure about the heading of the title of this. I think it is experimental heat transfer. I'm just searching Google book search so that I will not make a mistake. Fluid mechanics measurements. It is experimental heat transfer. Correct. It is experimental heat transfer. Correct. I am not wrong. experimental heat transfer by Goldstein. Okay, so these two books should be very good study material, or it can be good beginning for, and of course there are plenty of ideas in various journal papers, that is very diffuse way of telling, but most of the ideas we get it from text, from papers only, journal papers only. Anything else, professor?
Sir, as a student, will you suggest the must books which we read on heat transfer, sir?
Okay, so okay, so as a student,
as a beginner,
as a beginner, what are the books we should be reading? I would suggest the following. If he is a UG student, that is undergraduate student, that is for BE or BTech, the best book what I like, or the best books what I like or I refer myself, and I think as a student it's a very good book, is Chengal, C-E-N-G-E-L. Actually you may feel that I should be pronouncing it as Sengal, but actually this is an Israeli name. There is a small tilde here sitting in the denominator, so that is what makes it called as Chengal. It is Chengal, heat transfer by Chengal, and recently I came to know that Chengal, along with Chengal, in the fourth edition there is a co-author. I don't remember because I forgot to bring that book with me today. The publisher has just given me the sample copy. Just on the, it was a coincidence that just on the day of starting workshop I got that book for fourth edition. But Chengal is a very good book. Why I say very good book? Because I call this as armchair reading. Armchair reading means I don't have to take special effort in understanding from Professor Chengal. He writes it so well. He writes it so well that every concept from one sentence to another sentence, there is a flow. There is a logic flowing, and he tells the same thing in twice in two different ways, so that I cannot miss out the concept. Another thing which is good about Chengal, which is good for a student, is that there is left hand side, there is the summary of the whole page in form of figures or in form of equations. After I read the page on the left hand side, if I close my eyes and that left hand side, whatever is there, if it comes onto my mind, that means I have understood that page. That is why that means this book is like a notes. It's not like a text, it is a notebook. That's about Chengal. Now another good book for problems is definitely, all of us know, that is Incorpora and Debit. Incorpora and Debit, it's not armchair reading book. You will have to make, for example, fins, if you are reading infinite fin length, it will just give in one sentence. Okay, I did not understand myself first time when I read that. It took a lot of time for me to understand. That's why the tan hyperbolic ml, if you remember, we have discussed that so much in length. But that thing is made understood by Chengal in one shot, because he has given one figure there, wherein which there is a temperature variation from base to the tip. Okay, so each book, I say every book is a good book, but there are few books which are not good, which we should not read. I will not take their names, okay, but Chengal and Incorpora are the best books for UG. Okay, this is what I suggest to my students. Incorpora and Debit, if someone does all exercise problems, as a teacher I would think I should be doing all exercise problems, and also as a student, if one does all exercise problems of Incorpora and Debit, he is master of heat transfer. Why? Because Incorpora and Debit, all problems, all numbers are real life numbers. They are not just cooked numbers or cooked problems. They are all real life problems. And apart from this, there are n number of books. One is Bejan, Heat Transfer by Bejan, very expensive book, but I like this book very much. Okay, this book is Heat Transfer. He is having two books, Heat Transfer and also convective heat transfer. As a teacher, I would think Bejan for convective heat transfer has to be read. I know my writing is not coming proper because there is some problem with the pen, but I am telling, please write down, this is convective heat transfer by Bejan. And of course, apart from this, there are n number of books. I think I will stop here. There is what is Ozisik is there, then Frank Reith is there. Frank Reith and Born. Frank Reith and Born. Frank Reith and Born is also very, very good book. But apart from all these books, main, the stand apart are the best books I would think are Changal, Incorpora and David. Of course, there are plenty of Indian books, but I will not take them. Okay. So, apart from these books, you read any book, you will, it will be a value addition only. There is nothing you are going to lose. After you read Changal and Incorpora and David, you read any book, it is fine with me. Okay. But first time if someone is reading, I would think you should start off with Changal. Okay. You have a question?
Sir, yesterday I have seen one slide in radiation, that is the rooftop of the house wherein the radiation is coming from the sun and one is coming from the trees. Okay. So, in radiation when it is coming from the sun, if the radiation passes through some other medium and then falls on the roof, then whether it affects the absorptivity?
See, the question is the rooftop problem, rooftop since yesterday we have been taking. See, in the morning also I solved. See, what did I say? Morning. How do I measure absorptivity? Absorptivity or emissivity? How do I get this? Reflectivity, transmissivity, absorptivity, emissivity, how am I getting? What we are saying is that it does not mean that surface properties are not at all important. Absorptivity comes from emissivity. Emissivity is the one which can be measured. Emissivity, reflectivity, transmissivity can be measured. When I measure this emissivity, reflectivity and transmissivity, they become the properties of the surface. Okay? Now, what we are saying is that for the absorptivity of that material will depend on the source temperature. That is, absorptivity of a plate or a given material at source temperature will be equal to emissivity of the source temperature. But emissivity at the source temperature is again dependent on the material properties. That's how material properties are accounted and also the temperature. Okay?
No, sir, if it is passed through a glass and then it is falling on the rooftop, if it passes through some other medium before falling it on the rooftop, then whether the absorption...
If it passes through the rooftop, what happens to the absorptivity of my material? Then where is it coming from? It is not coming from the sun, it is now coming from the rooftop glass. So, sorry, between the rooftop and the sun there is a glass. Now my source has become glass. Okay? So, now you have complicated the problem. So, because now I really do not know, I think it will be still dependent on the temperature of the source, I still insist that. But how much it will come, that is the wavelength dependency, that is what wavelength is passing through this glass is dependent on the transmissivity of the glass, but still the absorptivity will be dependent on the source temperature. Okay? So, I think we will get started with tutorial today. We are lagging behind. Let me get started with the first problem. Yes, there is in the chat, there is a question that you will give me a download historical perspective. It is not a link, it is a journal paper. I will give you the reference of that paper. Okay? Just bear with me, I will today send it across. Okay? I was still, yesterday night I was working out with that emissivity concept. I had to spend time, I have not checked even a single email till today. Okay? So, I will do that before I go today, I will send it across. Okay? Now, let us get started with, see, let us take up problem number 47. Now, be equivalent. So, there are two parallel plates. One is surface 1, another one is surface 2. Okay? and the parallel plate size is given by 1 meter by 0.5 meter, both the surfaces are of same size, and the distance between the two plates is 0.5 meter apart. Okay. So, now the emissivities of the plates are epsilon 1 equal to 0.2, epsilon 2 equal to 0.5. Then these two are exposed to, and one plate is maintained at 1000 degree Celsius and the another one is maintained at 500 degree Celsius, and both are exposed to ambient, which is T infinity equal to 27 degree Celsius. The plates exchange heat with each other and the room, but only the plate surfaces facing each other need to be considered in the analysis. Find the net transfer to each plate and to the room, that is the question. Okay? So, now what are we saying? The same whatever circuit I had drawn will be valid, but with an assumption, with a truncation. What is that? Let us call this as surface 1, this is already 1, 2, let ambient be 3. Okay? So, same circuit let me draw, this is EB1, J1, what will be this resistance? What is this? Is it space resistance or surface resistance? Surface resistance, 1 minus epsilon 1 A1 epsilon 1, then you have J2, that is 1 upon A1 F1 2. Okay. Next is, this is J2, next is EB2, and what is this resistance? 1 minus epsilon 2 upon A2 epsilon 2. Okay. And then I have J3, and J1, J3 are connected, J2, J3 are connected. J1, J3, what is the resistance between J1, J3? 1 upon A1 F1 3, and this is 1 upon A2 F2 3. Okay. Now, what about J3? What about EB3? Here actually we had resistance EB3 and we had 1 minus epsilon 3 upon A3 EB3. What was that? What was that resistance? Resistance of the surface. Is my air participating? Is it having an emissivity? No, it is having nil emissivity. That means 1 minus epsilon becomes 0. So, that is why I do not have resistance. If I do not have resistance, what will be J3? J3 will become equal to EB3. J3 will become equal to EB3. That is all the catch in this problem. Okay? If we understand this J3 equal to EB3, rest all is straightforward. Nevertheless, I will go ahead and solve this problem. Other way of looking at it is, instead of looking at it from epsilon alone, epsilon 3 A3, because you might be thinking 1 by 0 is coming, what should I do? My A3 is infinite, you think like that. If A3 is infinite, what will happen to my resistance? As A3 tends to infinity, this resistance tends to 0. That is what is happening here, that is what makes it J3 equal to EB3. Is that okay? So, now let us do the problem for the sake of completion, so that I do not miss out anything. So, if I set up the equations, what are the equations? EB1, Samir, you will have to help me, EB1 minus J1 upon 1 minus epsilon 1 upon A1 epsilon 1 plus J2 minus J1 upon 1 upon A1 F1 2 plus J3 or EB3 minus J1 upon 1 upon A1 F1 3 equal to 0. Similarly, for node 2, what does, let me take node 2, what do I get? EB3 minus J2 upon 1 upon A2 F2 3 plus EB2 minus, correct, EB2 minus J2 upon 1 minus epsilon 2 A2 epsilon 2 plus J1 minus J2 upon 1 upon A1 F1 2 equal to 0. Okay. What is EB1? EB1 equal to sigma T1 to the power of 4. That is, sigma T1 to the power of 4 means 148.87 kilowatts per meter square. What is T1? 1000 degree Celsius. T1 is 1000 degree plus 273, you get 1273 to the power of 4. Then EB2, what is EB2? Sigma T2 to the power of 4, T2 is 500, that is 773 Kelvin. If I substitute that, I get 20.24 kilowatts per meter square. Similarly, EB3 equal to sigma T3 to the power of 4, T3 is 300 Kelvin. Okay? T3 is 300 Kelvin. I get a EB3 of 0.4592 kilowatts per meter square. I got EB1, EB2, EB3. In these two equations, what are the unknowns? J1 and J2. What are not known is, J1 is not known and J2 is known. Do I know epsilon 1? What is epsilon 1? 0.2. Epsilon 1 is 0.2. What is A1 equal to? A1 equal to 0.5 into 1, that is 0.5 meter square. Is that right? Now, epsilon 1 I know. Do I know F1 2 and F1 3? No, I do not know. I have to calculate. So, I will calculate F1 2 and F1 3. If I calculate F1 2 and F1 3 and I substitute that and solve these two equations, I will get J1 and J2. Let us do that. That is, what is F1 2? How will I get F1 2? F1 2, it is very difficult. It is not impossible, but difficult to get from the equation. I have just put, I am just putting the value which you can get from the chart. Okay? That is taking the between two parallel plates. You take two parallel plates, you get, I am writing directly F12 as 0.285. Okay? Now, what is F11 plus summation rule F12 plus F13? 11 to itself. 1, 2 is 1 plate to the second plate, 1, 3 is plate to surroundings, that is atmosphere. So, F11, what is F11? 0. So, F12 I have got point, I have made a mistake, no one has corrected me. This is equal to 1. So, 0.285 plus F13 equal to 1. So, F13 equal to 0.715. Okay. Is that enough or anything else I need? I need in my thing F23, sorry, yeah, F13 I have got, F12 I have got, I need F23 now. How will I get F23? F13 is equal to F23 by symmetry, because both the plates are there. If you see here, both the plates are seeing the atmosphere. They are symmetric with respect to atmosphere. So, F12 is equal to F13. This is equal to F, sorry, F23. I said F12 equal to F13, not that. F13 equal to F23. Now, if I substitute all these numbers in the previous equation, what do I get? I am going to get, what do I get? J1 and J2. You will find that J1 is 33.43 kilowatts per meter squared and J2 equal to 14.4884 kilowatts per meter squared. What is the question asked? What is that we are looking for? What is that we are looking for? We are looking for net heat transfer to each plate and to the room. Okay. What is the heat lost? What is the heat transfer by the plate? Let me go ahead and write heat lost by the plate, because I know that heat lost by the plate. Because why it is heat lost by the plate, I am saying so confidently, because it is sitting at a higher temperature, plate 1, it is sitting at 1000 degree Celsius. What is that given by Q1 equal to Eb1 minus J1 upon 1 minus epsilon 1 upon A1 epsilon 1. What do I get from this? I get 14 minus 43 kilowatts per meter square. Okay. So, similarly, heat lost by plate 2, Q2 would be equal to what? Eb2 minus J2 upon 1 minus epsilon 2 upon A2 epsilon 2 is equal to what do I get? If I substitute, I get 2.6785 kilowatts per meter square. Now, what is the heat received by the room? Heat is received by the room. What is that it is heat received by the room? Next is heat received by the room, that is equal to, what is that equal to? Heat received by the room. There are two resistances. You see, you go back to the circuit. I am just seeing the heat flux. That is, what is the current? See, why did I write for plate 1 Eb1 minus J1 upon 1 minus epsilon 1 by A1 epsilon 1? That is the heat flux. That is the heat lost by the plate. And for what is the current which is, go to the circuit here. You will understand. How am I writing? I am not writing from the air. This is the heat flux which is heat lost by the plate. This is the heat flux which is heat lost by the plate 2. What is the heat gained by room is J1 minus J3 upon this plus J2 minus J3 upon this. Current is heat flux, is not it? So, J1 minus J3 upon 1 upon A1 F13 plus J2 minus J3 upon 1 upon A2 F23. What do I get? I get heat received. I get it as 16.945. Actually, I will get them as negative. Okay. So, net energy from plates 1 and 2 should be absorbed by the room, is not it? Whatever is gaining from the plates has to be absorbed. So, what is that we got for? What is that we got for plate 1 and 2? Q1 plus, this is, let us call this as Q3. Q1 plus Q2, if you do, that is 14.43 plus 2.68, if you do, you are going to get it as 17.1085. These two are just, that is the net energy. See, at the end of the day, as Professor Arun was saying, you do whatever circus, energy balance has to. Okay. So, this is the energy balance. Okay. Any radiation problem for that matter, why any problem in heat transfer, check for energy balance. So, we will take questions. We will go to Amrita Coimbatore.
Yes. Sir, we have something like 1-1 parallel flow shell and tube bead exchanger and 1-1 counter flow shell and tube bead exchanger, sir. It is a one time flow on shell and one time flow on tube side.
Okay, one pass you mean,
one pass in shell side and one pass in tube side. So, we have something like 1-1 parallel flow shell and tube bead exchanger and 1-1 counter flow shell and tube bead exchanger even. Whereas, in the case of while the number of pass increases in tube side, while the number of pass increases in tube side like twice or four times, right, only then we are unable to classify the exchanger as a parallel flow and a counter flow. And this has been quoted in books even, sir.
Which book you said?
McCabe and Smith.
Okay, what is the issue now?
Chemical engineering book.
What is the issue? What is the issue now? No, what is the issue?
No, the issue is, say, It isn't an issue, sir, but we have something like 1-1 parallel flow event. Say in a shell and tube bidirectional event, you have something like parallel flow and a counter flow. If it is one pass, single pass.
No, I don't agree. Sorry, I don't agree. Because even if it is 1-1 shell, on the shell side, it is coming normally, the flow is coming normally. And see, the question asked by one of the participants is that in a 1-1 shell and tube heat exchanger, I am having a shell like this and I am having only a single tube. And now, the claim is that now, if it is a single tube, it is going to be a perfect parallel flow heat exchanger. I do not agree, professor, with you. Why? Because the flow is coming normally, now it has to turn around and then go. Maybe the argument is that maybe for the first initial phase wherein which it is taking a turn, there it is sort of, there is some variation in the heat transfer coefficient will be very high. Subsequently, then it has to become flow is in the developing region. And if I have baffle plates, then everything is mixed. Maybe you are talking when there are no baffle plates. Even if there are no baffle plates, I do not agree with you that it is going to be a perfect parallel flow heat exchanger.
If you have a shell and tube heat exchanger with one tube and one pass, then why have a shell and tube heat exchanger? You can have a double pipe heat exchanger.
That is a tube and tube, no?
Right.
Then it is a tube and tube. If you call one shell, one pass, then it is going to be tube and tube. Then it is no longer shell and tube heat exchanger. So perhaps you are meaning tube and tube heat exchanger and then calling it a shell and tube heat exchanger. Is that right?
Heat exchanger with that many number of tubes in it, and the pass goes like 1-2.
Professor, I think this is getting very specific. You please put up this in Moodle. We will get back to this. This is just a matter of nitpicking. I don't think there is any conceptual issue. Any other questions from the center, please?
That's it, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. NIT 3K, any questions quickly?
Sir, one question, sir. Pool boiling, during nucleate boiling, the bubble is formed at the surface and it is moving upwards. It is going against the gravity. When you are going up against the gravity, we have to go, velocity must be 11.2 km per second escape velocity. Whether it is due to the buoyancy effect or any other reason for this, sir, please comment on this.
Yeah. Okay. See, very interesting question actually. The question is, the bubble is formed and the bubble is trying to go up and it has to go against the gravity, and the conception is that, the thinking here is that it has to go at escape velocity. See, here we are not trying to escape from Earth's atmosphere. We are not transporting the bubble to the atmosphere, to the space. Here we want our bubble to get into the, from the bottom surface to the top surface of my boiling vessel, isn't it? So all that I need is density gradient. The density gradient creates the velocity. Again, natural convection sort of thing only. Only thing is that while the bubble is going up, it gets condenses and it may not all the time reach the top wall. That's what professor was saying earlier. So all the time it may not reach the top wall. Before it reaches the upper surface, I mean top surface means free surface of the liquid, it may get condensed. Okay. So it is, first thing is, it's not escape velocity. Okay.
Buoyancy force is still there.
Buoyancy force is still there. That is what is, density gradient only is driving that, and that is creating the velocity. Is that okay? So please don't confuse with escape velocity with the velocity with which the bubble is moving. Very good thought process, no problem. But escape velocity is that velocity for my rocket to zip into the space. But here bubble is not zipping into space. It is just coming from the bottom of the base to the free surface of the liquid. That is all it is. Okay?
No, sir. Again, it is, there is effect of gravity, no, sir. That point only I am asking.
Yes.
The gravity will pull that bubble downwards, but it is moving against gravity. So,
yeah, understood. See, the question... Yeah, understood. Your thought process is, it is going against the gravity. How come it is able to go against the gravity? Now you see, it has become vapor. If it has become vapor, means what has happened to its density? what has happened to its density? What is the density of the vapor? It is almost nearing to 1, okay? But what is the density of water? 1000. So now it has become 1000 times lighter. If it has become 1000 times lighter, it has no option but to float. It has to move up. But while moving up, it may lose its this lower density because the vapor may get condensed and become liquid. In that process, density difference is lost and drop has collapsed. So it is the density difference. Yes, you are very right, gravity is required. If there is no gravity, it could not have floated. This experiment, I cannot do it in space. You are very right. That's what perhaps you mean by saying that gravity is required. As we said in natural convection, you need not only density difference, but also the gravity. That's what perhaps you are emphasizing. Is that okay, Professor?
Sir, thank you, sir. Yeah. Over and out.
Yeah. VPCOE Baramati, quickly a question.
Hello, sir. My question is about the typical boiling curve. You know, practically in our lab, can you achieve the curve C2D curve and whether the point E or C we are getting, that is the melting point of the wire?
The question asked is, when we do the experiment, will we be able to capture the point D? See, when we do the experiment under, it depends on the boundary condition. See, we have to thank Professor Nukiyama for this, for generating this equation. In fact, this equation should be called, this curve should be called as Nukiyama curve. It is professor from Japan who was considered as expert in boiling long time back. Okay, just I will give you small history because I like to give this history. Professor Nukiyama was such a good professor in boilers, in building boilers. He was invited by Americans and he was called to US Embassy in Japan. What is the capital of Japan? Tokyo. He was called to Tokyo from one of the villages. So he went. And he did not take TADA from their embassy. He was so nationalistic because it was just immediately after Second World War and he was so much against America because they had bombed them. He said that I am going to do nothing for these Americans and I am going to build boilers only for my Japan. That was so nationalistic he was. The full credit of this boiling curve goes to Professor Nukiyama. In fact, we have to call this as Nukiyama curve. If you see this paper, how this curve has been generated, it is published in IJHMT, that is International Journal of Heat and Mass Transfer. It is actually first published in 1952, but on invitation, it was republished in 1972. Such very rarely we get papers invited again, because we usually send papers and they get accepted or rejected. This paper is not like that. It was specially invited. What is so great about this paper is that experiments have been done so carefully. They have done once with nichrome wire, they have done with stainless steel wire, they have done with various material. Repeatability tests have done so carefully, so meticulously. The word meticulous only can fill in this carefulness here, what is mentioned in this paper. Such a care has been taken in doing this experiment. Now, coming back to the issue, the issue is I can capture C2. Usually when we do the experiment under constant heat flux boundary condition, I am moving from C to E directly, C to E directly. Only when I do under constant temperature boundary condition, I will be traversing through to C, D and E. And there is hysteresis. If you see, there are two dotted lines, black lines here from E, D and A. So even if I come back on constant heat flux boundary condition starting from E, you will come from E to D and then from E to nearing about a point little above A. Point is, pool boiling curve is having hysteresis. It is not having in both the directions, it is not going to follow the same curve. So it depends on the boundary condition. Nukiyama, when he first did experiments, he only found C and he went into D. He understood arrow. No, I don't need arrow actually. They know what it is. So here the point is, he predicted what would happen between C, D and E. Again, it took 10 years. I don't remember. There was one more professor who did the experiment under constant wall temperature and built this. And all this data has been amalgamated and given to us as pool boiling curve. Actually, this should be called as Nukiyama's curve. Okay.
Hello, sir. One more question. In yesterday's discussion about emissivities, we have observed that with increase in absolute temperature, emissivity of all the bodies was increasing.
Whereas
for aluminium oxide, it was decreasing. Please, aluminium oxide was having lesser emissivity with increase in temperature, sir.
Yeah. Please, okay. Question
make
is
this point clear, sir.
Yeah, yeah.
Over to you, sir.
Yeah, question is, the question by one of the teachers is that we have emissivity for most of the metals increasing with the increase of the temperature, but for alumina it is decreasing. I cannot answer directly this because in the morning session I have given epsilon as a function directly related to temperature, which is sitting in the numerator, and there is another parameter called sigma e, which is electrical conductivity, which is sitting in the denominator. How this emissivity increases with the increase of the temperature and decreases with the increase of electrical conductivity decides my nature of the emissivity variation with temperature. That is all I can say. You will have to sit down and calculate for aluminium oxide whether this sigma E and T, how does it vary. But still, it is very simplistic explanation, very difficult to explain from electromagnetic wave theory, all these things very specifically.
Thank you, sir. Sir, one more question.
The question is about the compact heat exchangers air density, that is a meter square per meter cube for human lungs is a 20,000, sir. So, can you elaborate its structure of the particular that part?
Yeah, yeah. See, the compact density, that is the we say that I did not mention that because of lack of time, it was there very much beta. We define what is that area, volume per area per volume or volume per area, I do not remember. Let me open that. The point is, whatever we do, we can never mimic nature, okay. So, it is very difficult to mimic nature. That is what I wanted to represent by that example, and it is given in Professor Chengal's textbook. That is why I put that lungs beta is beta of lungs. So, beta of car radiator is 1000. What is beta? Heat transfer surface area upon volume. We want in order to make it compact for a given volume, I need to get more surface area. Why more surface area? Because I can get more load. Because for a given UAS delta T decides my heat load. So, but for human lungs, I do not know the design of the human lungs, okay. I do not know that, but all that I know is human lungs is highly dense, highly compact. That is, it is having 20,000 meter squared per meter cube. I have given that number. Why? Because even if we design whatever circus we do, I do not think we can exceed that number, 20,000. It's like the ideal number what I should have. It's very difficult to mimic nature. It's very difficult to mimic. We are talking about micro air vehicles and many things. How difficult it is for the, how difficult for us to take off the way pigeon takes off. It's not at all easy. We can make videos and see how pigeon takes off and how it modulates its wing shape while taking off and while, what is that? While touching down, while landing. It's not that easy if you are doing with aircraft, it is not easy. Point is, by taking all these examples, is that we can never mimic nature, or we cannot be performing any machine cannot perform as good as a human being. That is why that beta of 20,000 is given. So, if we can make a compact heat exchanger which is having beta greater than 20,000, on that day we can say that we have beaten human design, that is nature's design, okay. So, I think we will take the next problem and we will come back to questions little later again. So, for a change we will do a problem on view factors. Problem number 45, a truncated cone has a top and bottom diameters as 10 centimeters and 20 centimeters respectively. The height of the truncated cone, that is the top one is 10 centimeters and bottom is 20 centimeters. And truncated cone length is having 10 centimeters height. Find the shape factor between the top surface, side surface, and this is another question everyone asks. What is the difference between shape factor, configuration factor, and view factor? Actually, they have all three are different. However, in our course, as long as we are handling non-participating media, all three mean the same. Configuration factor, shape factor, view factor. All three mean the same. So, we should not be puzzled about seeing any three of this. And another thing what I forgot to tell in the morning is that emissivity absorptivity, transmissivity, that is EVT, is referred usually for smooth pure surfaces. Emissivity, transmissivity and absorptivity is used for smooth surfaces. Emittance, absorptance, transmittance is used for rough and contaminated surfaces. This is according to, who has told us this? This is National Standards, NIST, National Institute Standards, American National Institute of Standards follows this. That's what, in fact, whatever material I taught in the morning, it is all from Professor Modest textbook, Radiative Heat Transfer from Modest. If someone wants to dig and understand more about this reflectivity and all, it is Professor M.F. Modest. And of course, Professor Arun has studied with Professor Modest itself. Professor Modest has taught him conduction. Okay. So, now let us get back to problem number 45. That is, we said that there are three surfaces. Now, let us find the shape factor between top surface and the side surface and itself. Okay. That is F23 and F33. Okay. So, now Ri equal to capital Ri equal to R small Ri by L, and Rj equal to, that is Ri by L.
L is the height.
L is the height. What is Ri now? Ri is 10 by 20 by, oh no, Ri I have taken 10 by 10. I am calling this as I and this as J, another thing, and J. Okay. So, Ri equal to, Ri by L equal to 1, yeah, Rj equal to, Rj by L equal to 0.5, small Rj by L equal to 0.5, you are right.
This is J, neither kick you, okay.
Yes, correct. Now, Ri by L is 1, Rj is 0.5. Now, Rj is 0.5. Okay, S equal to 1 plus Rj squared, no, again 1 plus Rj plus 1 within the bracket, standalone. Upon Ri square plus 1, okay, equal to 2.25. Now, Fij equal to 0.5 into bracket open S minus S squared 4 into Rj by Ri whole squared, this bracket. There is a bracket between here and there, okay. Sorry, to the power of 1 by 2, again one flower bracket we can put, okay. That is equal to 0.117. That is for F12. We got now F12 as 0.117. Why we have used IJ notation? Because that is in line with the relations what are typed in our notes. That is why I have gone back to IJ notation, okay. Now, reciprocity rule, A1F12 equal to A2F21, A1F12 equal to A2F21. So, I get F21 equal to 0.469. Now, summation rule tells me F11 plus F12 plus F13 equal to 1. F11 is 0. F12 little while ago I have got 0.117 and F13 will become 0.883. Now, F23 will become equal to 1 minus F21 because F22 is 0, okay, that is equal to 0.531. Now, F31 equal to A1 F13 upon A3. Okay. And similarly, F32 equal to A2 F23 upon A3. Now if I substitute the areas, I get F31 as 0.5265, 0.5265, and F23 as 0.079. So F33 will become equal to 1 minus of F32 and F31. That's it. I get 0.3945. That is how. Note this. F33 is not equal to 0. Okay. So it is all by geometry. See, view factor is nothing but finding areas, how much one surface is the other surface. That is all it is. Actually, it is geometry. Okay. So with this, we will take we will take next problem and then we will start taking questions. So we will quickly solve one problem. Let us take the last problem, problem number 53. So we have saturated steam.
The data is correct.
Yeah, the data is correct. So we will get started with the solution. So that's what some confusion was going on. Okay, Q equal to m dot HFG, that is the load. M dot is given to be, what is the problem given? M dot is given to be 2.3 kg per second. So 2.3 kg into HFG is 2257 kilojoule per kg. I get 5.191 × 10⁻⁶ watts. Okay, so this heat should be equal to the heat gained by the water. So m dot C CPC into delta TC, that is TC naught minus TCI. TCI is given to be 15 degree Celsius, and m dot, do I know m dot? M dot is not known.
Velocity.
Yeah. So we will come to this little later on, because here number of tubes will come into n, into m dot Cp into n, assuming that m is per tube. Okay. Now let us calculate Reynolds number. Reynolds number equal to UMD by nu. UM is 3.5, diameter is 14 mm, 14 × 10⁻³, we have goofed up completely. Okay. Upon 959 × 10⁻⁶. That's right. Now it is right. 959 × 10⁻⁶. So equal to 50,993. Almost same problem. So this is comedy of errors. Okay. Nusselt number I get 0.023, that is I get 285.8114 using Dittus-Boelter correlation. So I get HD as 12371.55. Yeah. Now it makes sense. There is no thickness given. So whatever we wrote earlier, no. So that is 1 upon HI plus 1 upon HO equal to 1 upon U. So, HI is 1237.55 and HO is 21,800. Is that right? Mm-hmm. 21,800 is HO and 1237.155, I get overall heat transfer coefficient as 7892.53. Okay. So, both are of the same order, so that is why my overall heat transfer, but still my overall heat transfer coefficient is lower than the two terms because of averaging. Okay. So, now effectiveness, what are we finding, what is the question asked? We need to find the number of the tubes. Okay. We are trying to find the number of tubes. So, how will I get number of tubes? I have to find NTU. For finding NTU, what should I know? I should be knowing the effectiveness and CR, that is the ratio of the specific heats. Now, first let us find effectiveness. Effectiveness equal to effectiveness equal to, what is effectiveness equal to here, q upon q maximum, that is equal to, I get q is 5.191 into 10 to the power of 6, we just now found 5.191 into 10 to the power of 6 upon m dot c CPC into THI minus TCI. That is the maximum temperature difference. This is by definition. So, that should be equal to
this m dot Cp is the total,
which is having all number of tubes in that. It is embedded in that. Okay. So,
m dot per tube times
n. Okay. Now, Cc equal to capital Cc, m dot CCPC equal to m dot c is rho a c u m into n, rho a c u m into n into CPC, which is CPC. So, rho is, we have just now found mass flow rate, did not we? No. Rho is, what is the rho? 998. Area is pi by 4 into 14 into 10 to the power of minus 3 whole squared into 3.5, let me calculate, okay, into 4181 CPC. So, I get 2249 n, okay. Now, epsilon n equal to, where is my epsilon? Okay. Yes. So, from this I get epsilon n equal to 27.154. That is epsilon. I need NTU, epsilon into n, still we have two unknowns. NTU equal to UA upon, quite a lengthy problem, heat exchanger problems are going to be like this, UA upon C minimum. UA is 7892.53 into pi dL, pi into D is 0.014 into L is 0.5. So, that is 2249 n. So, n gets, you are right, n gets cancelled out. So, this is, we have to take the net surface area. This is the overall heat transfer coefficient, and in the denominator we have C minimum, which is accounting for overall. So, that is the reason n gets cancelled out and I get 0.1543. So, effectiveness equal to 1 minus of e to the power of, here 2 is multiplied. Here in the numerator I have to multiply by 2 because it is 2 tube pass. So, yeah. Okay. So, epsilon equal to 1 minus of e to the power of minus n to u, I get 0.143. So, I have already got epsilon n equal to 27.154. From that, I will get n equal to 189.88, which has to be 190 tubes. Outer wall temperature, one can calculate by simple energy balance. Let us do that. Outlet water temperature TCO equal to 15 plus in the numerator 5.191 into 10 to the power of 6 upon 2249 into 190. What is this? this is 90 190 tubes and 2249 was per tube equal to you get 27.15. It has not increased much, okay. And condensation, maximum condensation rate is when Q equal to Q maximum. What is Q maximum? 5.191 × 10⁶ watts upon m dot, sorry, HFG 2257 upon
effective is equal to m dot
HFG. Correct. So, is equal to 16 kg per second. Correct. 16 kg per second.
Effectiveness is?
Effectiveness is 0.143. So, we get 16 kg per second. I think quickly we will take some questions. So much about the tutorial for today. We will take some 5 to 6 questions here and there before we sign off.
Indore, SGSITS, any questions?
There is a question related to NTU, number of transfer unit. Yes, I know that number of transfer unit is the measure of the size of heat exchanger, but I want to know more about it. So, my first question is, what is the physical significance of NTU? And next question is, what we can predict about heat exchanger if we have calculated the NTU? Over to you.
Okay, question is, what is the physical significance of NTU over and above understanding that it is the size of the heat exchanger, that is AS. And apart from that,
what we can predict about the heat exchanger.
What you can predict about the heat
exchanger. What one can predict, what one can predict about the heat exchanger with NTU. Okay. NTU only means, we keep saying this area, this also we have to keep in the back of our mind. Whenever we say NTU is a measure of the area for the same overall heat transfer coefficient and C minimum, not always. So, if the overall heat transfer coefficient changes, again area changes. But when I change the design configuration, many a times my overall heat transfer coefficient also changes, then my NTU changes. For a given U and for a given C minimum, that means for a given mass flow rate and for given two fluids, for a given heat transfer coefficients, that means for a given mass flow rates, heat transfer coefficients get fixed if my dimensions get fixed, that is diameters. What is not fixed is length. So, this AS only means for a given U and C minimum means actually my diameters are fixed. What is not fixed is length. It only gives us the idea of length. When I say that because I am keeping my U and C minimum constant or same. But if I change that, then area also increase or decrease has no meaning to say. Now, professor wants to add something else, he has written something else over to professor. So, what professor is saying is that it is a measure of NTU is NTU or delta T LMTD more or less is turning out to be the same. If you see UAS, I can write it as Q upon delta T LMTD. And C minimum, I can write it as Q upon T C naught minus T C m. What is NTU? NTU is nothing but delta T LMTD. So, higher the NTU means higher delta T LMTD. That is all it is. Lower the delta T LMTD. So, NTU is also giving me a measure of delta T LMTD. If lower delta T LMTD is there, means I will have higher NTU, which is correct, na? If I have lower delta T LMTD, I will definitely, that means temperature differences are less, then my surface area required is, or the size of the heat exchanger has to go up. I think other than this, I do not think I can give any other answer. And the second part, NTU does not tell anything about the heat exchanger type or anything. So, second part, I do not think I can, we can give any conclusive answer with just NTU, okay. YC College, Nagpur.
Hello sir, my question is, two fluids with different properties flow with equal stream velocities parallel to a flat plate. Sir, what property of the fluid determines whether the velocity boundary layer of one is thicker than the other?
Anyway, see, the question is, there is a flat plate and on a flat plate two fluids are flowing. Two fluids are flowing and nothing has been specified, but we are assuming that these two fluids are having different viscosities. Who will decide the boundary layers? and which one is thicker than the other? It depends on the viscosity. It depends on the viscosity. Definitely, the denser one will flow below and the lighter one will flow above, definitely, but that does not decide the boundary layer thickness. But the boundary layer thickness is decided by my viscosity. If you see, we derived by scale analysis, delta is of the order of L REL to the power of half. That is that right? L REL to the power of half, correct. So, as Reynolds number is increasing, that means as I am marching from the tip of the flat plate, the boundary layer is increasing. So, this is going to decide which one is going to be thicker, whether fluid 1 or fluid 2, because in Reynolds number both density and viscosity together are embedded. And moreover, both the fluids need not have to move at the same velocity, there will be relative velocity also. Okay?
Sir, my question is, value of heat transfer coefficient does not depend upon temperature difference and rate of heat transfer. So, does this concept hold good for boiling and condensation also?
This is a very good question. The question is, we were telling that in the forced convection, heat transfer coefficient is not going to be dependent on temperature difference and heat flux. Is this true in case of boiling and condensation? Very good question. We have missed this point. You have asked a very good question. Yes, I cannot make this statement. In fact, if you take pool boiling curve, no one plots heat transfer coefficient. Everyone plots Q double dash versus T wall minus T sat. Why? Let us go to the definition of heat transfer coefficient. How have we defined heat transfer coefficient in two phase flow? H equal to Q double dash upon T wall minus T sat. Is this T sat right reference temperature? Not. Why? Professor told us there is subcooled boiling and also saturated boiling. In case of subcooled boiling, my reference temperature is not going to be saturated temperature. My temperature of the bulk fluid will be lower than the saturated temperature. So, reference temperature in the definition of heat transfer coefficient itself is under problem. That is H equal to Q double dash upon T wall minus T sat. T sat, it is arbitrarily chosen because it is a fixed number for two phase flow. So, we should not plot H as a function of, we should plot always Q double dash and T wall minus T sat separately. To give one line answer for your question, H is not independent of Q double dash and T wall minus T sat for the simple reason that T sat taken as a reference temperature is not right. Okay.
Sir, this H also independent of temperature difference and Q in case of natural convection.
Yeah. So, coming to natural convection.
Yes, whatever this concept is, H is independent of temperature difference.
Correct. I had answered this question in the morning again. Yeah. The question is, in natural convection, is heat transfer coefficient dependent or independent of heat flux and temperature difference? Let us get to heat transfer coefficient in natural convection. How is it? What is it dependent on? Nusselt number is dependent on Grashof and Prandtl number. What is Grashof number? G beta delta T L cube divided by alpha nu. So, delta T is sitting. That means heat transfer coefficient is a function of delta T. If I take constant heat flux boundary condition, I can define Grashof number on the basis of constant heat flux. So, the crux of the matter is, for free convection, heat transfer coefficient is going to be a function of temperature difference and heat flux. Let me summarize, because so many questions. Heat transfer coefficient is independent of heat flux and temperature difference only in forced convection, not in natural convection and two phase flow heat transfer, no matter whether it is boiling or condensation.
In natural convection, looking at the equation, it is very clear. But think of it physically, only when you have a temperature difference, you have a buoyancy effect. If I have a larger temperature difference, larger is the density difference, larger is the buoyancy effect, larger is the heat transfer rate. So, there itself, I am able to say that, you know, your coffee cooling, that's just think of real life example. Larger the temperature difference, the cooling is faster.
That is the driving force, that is the pump. In natural convection, temperature difference is the pump, there is no other pump, that is the driving force. If there is no temperature difference, there is no driving force, no natural convection. That is what professor is trying to emphasize. Okay.
My question is that if we consider heat exchangers, then in heat exchangers, is it really necessary to consider LMTD? As considering AMTD also, we are going to get the same value for, matlab, approximately same value for AMTD and LMTD.
Question is whether I should take arithmetic mean temperature difference or logarithmic mean temperature difference for the design of the heat exchanger. You see, Professor Arun emphasized while he taught LMTD in convective heat transfer, he said that there was one transparency wherein which it was emphasized that if one takes average mean temperature difference, one can make an error of as high as 15% to 20%. Only if the temperature differences are not very large, we can get away with arithmetic mean temperature difference. So, the safest route is to always take logarithmic mean temperature difference so that we do not commit mistake. The summary is we cannot afford to take arithmetic mean temperature difference, better we stick to logarithmic mean temperature difference. That is the answer for your question. I think we will stop for the day.